Good evening, everyone, and a warm welcome to this talk by Sri Rajiv Malhotra on Kurukshetra of Sanskrit Studies, Who Decides the Adhikara, organized jointly by Samskrita Sangha and Prastuta. Before we begin, I would like to give a brief introduction to Samskrita Sangha and Prastuta. Samskrita Sangha is a cultural body of the students, staff and faculty of IISc. The Sangha, which has been an active body for more than three decades, aims at promoting a better understanding and awareness of Sanskrit language, Indian culture and heritage. The Sangha conducts talks and lectures by eminent scholars and professionals, spoken and written Sanskrit classes and workshops. Prastuta is a group of students of IISc, is an organization of students aimed at informing the institute community about national issues and a rich cultural heritage. Prastuta organizes regular talks by eminent personalities on relevant socio-economic and cultural topics. It is worth noting that Rajiv Ji's Being Different was released in the same hall in the presence of again Professor Roddam Narasimha and T.V. Mohandas Pai way back in 2012. So this is in many ways is a repeat of 2012. So with that introduction to Samskrita Sangha and Prastuta, I would like to invite a speaker, Sri Rajiv Malhotra, and the chief guest, Professor Roddam Narasimha, to traditionally inaugurate the event by lighting the lamp. Thank you, sirs. I request Sri Rajiv Malhotra and Professor to take the seat on the dais.
Today our speaker is Mr. Rajiv Malhotra. Mr. Malhotra is an activist, researcher, writer and speaker on the character and place of Hinduism in the globalizing world. He took an early retirement in 1994 at the age of 44 to pursue establishment of Infinity Foundation in 1995. This foundation, it promotes Indic studies. Along with many publications, he has authored popular books such as Breaking India, Being Different, Indra's Net, and latest edition is Battle for Sanskrit, which will be released today. Welcome, sir. And our chief guest for today's event is Professor Roddam Narasimha. Professor Roddam Narasimha is a pioneering scientist in the areas of aerospace and fluid dynamics. He was a professor of aerospace engineering at IISc, director of National Aerospace Laboratories, NAL, director of NIAS, and the chairman of Engineering Mechanics Unit at JNCISR, Bangalore. He is now an honorary professor at JNCISR and concurrently holds the Pratt & Whitney Chair in Science and Engineering at the University of Hyderabad. He had also held various visiting positions at Caltech, Cambridge Universities, NASA. He is actually a distinguished alumnus of both Caltech and as well as IISc, and he was honored with Padma Bhushan in 1987 and Padma Vibhushan, the India's second highest civilian award, in 2013. Welcome, Professor. And today we have another chief guest. He is Mr. T.V. Mohandas Pai. Unfortunately, he got stuck in traffic. He'll be joining us late. Thank you.
Thank you, Ashasvi. We'll now move to the central part of the event. I request Sri Rajiv Malhotra to deliver his speech now.
Namaskar, and thank you for coming for this event. I'd like to give a little overview of the book and then discuss one aspect specifically, because Roddam is here and he's a top-notch scientist, also interested in Sanskrit, so I have one aspect that I want to highlight and hopefully get his view on that. The book overall is positioning a debate between insiders and outsiders. Insiders being those who view the Sanskrit and Sanskriti traditions as with Shraddha, with their own sadhana. It's part of their sadhana. It's their heritage. They're invested in it. It's not just something random. And it's not just an ordinary language. So these are insiders. Outsiders are those who either reject the Vedic Shruti completely, or they're sort of mildly tolerant to it, but they're not really seriously invested. And they're looking at it objectively as an outsider, studying somebody else's culture or somebody else's identity. Because of the colonial history, which we haven't recovered from, we're still mentally colonized, the outsiders have controlled traditionally the study of Sanskrit, and it's called Indology. It started with the British, and now it's controlled mainly by the Americans. So the empire has shifted across the Atlantic, in a sense. And what used to be West European Orientalism became what I'm calling American Orientalism. And now this influence of the West in Sanskrit studies is even more than it used to be in the colonial times, because in the colonial times, it used to be white people studying all this, sitting in places like Oxford. Now, a huge number of Indians have been sent there to learn this stuff and come back. So now it's being propagated also by Indians. And so these, it looks more authentic because Indians are talking about it. But the knowledge, the theories, the Siddhant, the frameworks are often driven by Western ideas and Western approaches. This is not an anti-West kind of a posture. It just says that there are many ways of looking at something, and all these ways are important. But unfortunately, the insider perspective has not been given fair share. It's often not present, or it's present in a denigrated way, or the insiders who are present are not very assertive. So the purpose of this book is to highlight what are the issues an insider would have with the outsider perspective. The outsider perspective being what is controlled by certain prominent Indologists in the United States particularly, and their students in this country. So that's the insider-outsider debate. I started writing this book when I realized that Shingeri Mutt was about to sign up one of the American Ivy Leagues to represent the whole legacy of Adi Shankara by setting up chairs, which some rich NRIs were funding, putting $4-5 million per chair. And the Adi Shankara legacy would be in their hands. They would select the professors, the speakers, how to run the show. And it concerned me that we were outsourcing this legacy without proper evaluation of who these people are and what's their history, what have they written about our tradition, and whether they're really qualified. So I started doing a report for the Shankaracharya. And that report started out as a 50-page report, then it became a 100-page report. And the more I studied about these Indologists, the more concerned, more red flags. So now it's a 500-page book. So this book is really the outcome of this research to provide due diligence to the Shingeri people so they can evaluate more about this particular chair. This was going to be announced in August or September or thereabouts, 2014. And it was just 4 weeks away from being announced. And when I intervened, they put it on hold. They haven't announced it yet, and we don't know which way it'll go, but we hope this book makes a difference in the evaluation of whether they should do this at all. Because one of my concerns is that the outsiders are the knowledge producers about our culture, and the insiders are consumers. So they are producing the knowledge, we are buying it, consuming it, our children and our media, the ideas on who we are being brought in by somebody else. This is not the case in China. China studies, Mandarin studies, are squarely controlled by their insiders. All the prestigious journals, conferences, academic centers are in China. Same is true for Persian studies in Persia, in Iran, Arabic studies in the Arabian countries, Japan studies, etc. So ours is the only major civilization whose intellectual discourse is controlled from the outside. And our people are very enthusiastic that they are paying attention to us. So it's sort of like a compliment that somebody else is studying us. So the way I located these outsiders is by looking at what is different in their discourse from the way the insiders have seen it. That doesn't mean it's wrong. Sometimes outsiders are better off, they're more objective, less emotionally invested. and that can be good. So I'm not opposed to others looking at it. I'm just looking at what exactly is their output that would be red flags. So one of the major concerns is the elimination of the sacred dimension. The whole paramarthika, what the Vedas call paramarthika, is being eliminated by this kind of school of thought because they consider it either superstition or they consider it backward, they consider it socially oppressive, exploitation, all of that Marxist critique gets applied. And then a large issue is they consider the whole Vedic tradition, and Sanskrit is sort of the leading culprit, is leading cause of it. The Vedas and Sanskrit together are seen as sort of socially oppressive. They are elitist, Brahmanical, and have oppressed women, Shudras, and so on. Another issue is the way the texts they study are seen through the lens of politics. This is political. The texts are for a political purpose. They were written for the elite to dominate, and that's how they're looking at it. And so the term they use is political philology. Political philology is a methodology to study these texts, and political philology means that philology is the study of texts, scientific or analytical or systematic way of looking at a text, finding its meaning. That's called philology. That is well known. There are many kinds of philologies different people have, but political philology is a new kind of a fashion, which means looking for the political motives in a text. But for us, there's no political motive necessarily. It's a spiritual motive. It's a text may be a sacred text, or a text may be a mathematical text, an astronomical text. It doesn't serve a political purpose. There's no agenda to go and get political power through that text. But that's what political philology is looking for. To respond to that, I've coined the term sacred philology and propose that we should balance the political philology method with the sacred philology method so we have a more even view. The outsiders want to look at it politically. I want to propose also look at it in a sacred way. So I started looking at who are these outsiders, how do you characterize them, what is distinct about them, and how should a traditional scholar from India look at, how would he relate to them? The point is that the sad fact is that the traditional scholars have not done the Purva-paksha of these Western Indologists. Purva-paksha is the art and science of studying the other on your own terms, understanding them in a very respectful way, and then giving an Uttar-paksha response. It's a very old Indian system. The different schools would do Purva-paksha on each other in a very civilized way, a very friendly manner, but very serious debates would happen. And somehow we have not done, our traditionalists have not done Purva-paksha of the dominant Western Indology or dominant schools of Indology. Either they are dismissive, that, oh, it doesn't matter, which is a cop-out, or they're very bombastic, very quick to sort of blast them without even paying attention, without even having taken the time to study, or they're plain old disinterested, living in a silo. They'll give you all kinds of excuses, but the fact is that unless, to keep a tradition vibrant, you must know other people's point of view and you must engage them. You cannot just isolate and sort of disregard them. You have to engage them. So this absence of Purva-paksha, I believe, is very costly. And this book is a Purva-paksha I'm doing of Western Indology, and I want more traditional scholars to join me. And I feel the traditional scholars are actually, they are the ones who ought to be doing it, not me. But one of the problems they have is they don't know English. A lot of the traditional Sanskrit scholars don't know English. I've given the books of Western Indologists to several traditional scholars and asked them for help. And after days, weeks, even months of trying, they've come back and said, we cannot make head or tail of what they're saying because it's very complicated English. It's not just ordinary English, it's complicated English. And it's not just English, but the idiom, and they are referring to Western thinkers that most of you would never have heard of. Thinkers like Benjamin, thinkers like Gramsci, Vico, which are not part of our general knowledge. So a traditional Sanskrit scholar, it's all kind of blue sky, it's all weird stuff. He has no idea what they're talking about. And yet they're talking about our culture. So even though the subject matter is Sanskrit and Sanskriti and Sanskrit studies, it's being done in such a way that the traditional scholar doesn't feel that he can understand. So what has happened is traditional scholars have withdrawn and they are not part of the global discourse on Sanskrit studies. This is the issue I'm trying to resolve. Now, the best way to describe, and this is where this segue will take me to a discussion with Roddam, I'm hoping. The best way to describe the school of thought that I'm critiquing is to think of them as a new kind of charvaks. Earlier charvaks, who you can call them charvak 1.0, were a school of thought that dismissed the Vedas, dismissed Shruti. They were dismissives of the sacred transcendental dimension. They were very empirically sharp. They believed in the material world and what you can see with your senses, like modern science in some ways. That is what the truth is. So the claims of the Vedas and all that, any Shruti type idea or spiritual idea would be dismissed. So that's what the Charvaks were. Charvaks were respectable people, very learned, very highly qualified in grammar and Sanskrit, and very fierce fighters and debaters. The Charvak 2.0 are the new Charvaks that is the subject of my study. In the sense of being materialists and rejecting the Vedas, they are similar to Charvak 1.0. But there are many new qualities that have entered Charvak 2.0, which did not exist previously. The Charvak 2.0 are basically materially very wealthy. They come from rich institutions. They have a lot of power, so they can control the discourse. They can deny the insiders equal play. They are connected with Western power centers. The Charvak 1.0 were not like that. They were modest people, and they were not sort of materially dominating or politically very strong. But the Charvak 2.0 can throttle, can choke the insider view from the Vedic side, which was not the case with Charvak 1.0. So they're more dangerous in a sense to the Vedic point of view. Now, the question is, in what ways has knowledge evolved since the early times till today? In what ways has knowledge changed that with reference to the Charvaks, whether it's 1.0 or 2.0, in what ways have things changed? And this, I think, is the crux of a point I want to discuss with Roddam. I've known Roddam for 25 years and had many discussions of this kind, so I'm very glad he's here. And as I understand it, Roddam is very strong on empiricism as a basis for establishing truth. And so were the Charvaks. So the Charvaks' idea was, since you cannot establish the truth in the Vedas empirically, so we got to reject them. That kind of a thing. Now, something interesting has happened, which was not possible before. Thanks to the West, actually the West has played a role. Now there is instrumentation to measure not your consciousness, but a correlate with your consciousness. I claim a certain state of consciousness. I claim I'm having a certain experience. Now I cannot publicly, we cannot do public verification because it's private. But what we can measure is some brain state. We can, with using an instrument, we can measure a brain state. So if Rajiv says, I did this mantra, this particular technique, and I tried it for 10 years, and I reached a certain state of bliss or anand or whatever the tradition calls it, and if the measurement develops a correlate, and then they try this with 100 other people who've tried the same kind of technique and who also claim that they got the same result. And they look at the correlate, the material physical correlate, the objective empirical correlate of different meditators' states, and they find something common. So they've isolated a signature. They've isolated a measurable signature which corresponds to a certain claim. So this is an inner claim with an outer measurement. It's not as hard empirically as looking at a galaxy, which 100 people can look through different telescopes and they all conclude the same thing. Or if you look at an electron microscope and do the same experiment, everybody can say we got similar results. We're talking about something which is not as hard and as solid, empirically verifiable in a public sense, but it is not as subjective and arbitrary as it used to be before this particular measurement was available. Because before this measurement was available, if somebody said, I'm experiencing this, well, you don't know what he's talking about. Maybe he is, maybe he's not. There's no way to evaluate it. And this correlative measurement is becoming more and more sophisticated. So we're not at a stage yet where a machine can say this is what you're thinking or you're sad or whatever, but it's really getting there. It's getting to a point where the inner experience as measured by people is getting more and more correlated with outer. I just came across a scientific paper in the US and some people who said that they are now able to, with objective measurements, tell when somebody who's an addict is about to slip back. In other words, whatever he's experiencing, his craving to go back and take that substance, they're able to predict before he actually does it. And hence they can get him help. So this is an example of the inner state, the adhyatmic state, being somewhat measurable, not perfectly. This opens the possibility that we now may have something we could call adhyatmic empiricism. So it is not external empiricism necessarily, but it is a kind of an inner science which is now verifiable. This is now beginning to become possible. And so this opens the possibility that the charvaks have to now upgrade their posture towards the transcendental claims, the inner claims, the spiritual claims, because to some extent these may be verifiable, publicly verifiable sense. And you cannot just simply dismiss all that. So that's one of the points of debate I want to start with the Charvak 2.0, that while the Charvak 2.0 is in his Sanskrit department in Columbia University, he doesn't know about these developments. Across the campus is a neuroscience department in the same university, and they are very excited about all this. So you have the inner science, cognitive science, neuroscience people are very excited about what they can now measure and consider to be scientific truth about yogic claims and things of that sort. And yet the department, which is supposed to be studying Sanskrit and whatnot, is very dismissive of all that and thinks it's all humbug and so on. So I'm also trying to create a debate between one kind of Westerner and another kind of Westerner. The scientific Westerner versus the one who studies these traditions in a very classical, philological manner. So that's an area I have. I was in an ashram a few days ago where I witnessed little kids demonstrating third eye awakening. Third eye awakening, I couldn't believe it, but one kid after another, you block their eyes, you check it out, you block their eyes, and they are totally blocked, and you get to do it yourself. And then you write whatever you want, and you hold it, and they can read it with eyes closed. Some of them can read it from behind also. And and this has been demonstrated by this group in the US and other places, and they are beginning to come out a little bit more into the open and have scientists measure this empirically so that it's verifiable. Now, of course, time will tell us exactly how much they've done, what it all means, but these sort of measurable claims are popping up more and more compared to what was the case in the previous eras. So that's the, maybe we need Charvak 3.0. Maybe we need Charvak 3.0. And the Charvak 2.0 I'm critiquing is obsolete because they are so dismissive, like the Charvak 1.0, they are so dismissive, and also they consider the tradition to be the cause of human rights violations. They're sort of Marxist leftist view of the whole Sanskriti tradition as a source of problems. Now, I do agree we have social problems. I'm not denying that. Every culture has these social problems, different kinds of social problems. But I don't think a wholesale dismissal of the tradition on that ground is a justified thing. So that's I could go on, but the clock tells me it's 6:25, and Roddam has to leave at 6:45. So what I want to do is stop and ask Roddam to give his comments, and then we continue the discussion. Thank you very much.
It's a great pleasure to be here with Mr. Rajiv Malhotra once again. As he said, we've been friends for now 25 years or so, and I've met each other sometimes here, sometimes in the US. And I followed his, almost one-man battles on a variety of issues, which are of great interest, I think, to the future of Sanskrit studies, of course, as he has emphasized in this particular book, but really of our civilization as a whole. And I think that, as Rajiv correctly pointed out, in India, a large number of people, and in particular the traditional scholars, are usually unaware of the criticisms that are being made abroad. Now, of course, there are occasionally people who praise what we've done, what we do, but that is widely known, but the criticisms are not so widely known. And now it's a time, once again, that's why we must thank Rajiv for pointing this out to a large Indian audience. It's time once again to see that another kind of colonialism is developing right in front of our eyes, and we are not aware of it. And this comes from the studies that have been made by some very prestigious scholars in the United States. And I've had a chance to look quickly through Rajiv's book. I must say that I've not read it fully at all, but I read it here and there, wherever it seemed to me that there was something that I should make a mention of. And I think it's something which everybody should read. Not only those who are interested in Sanskrit, certainly they, all of them should read it, but even others. I think it's very important to be aware of what's being said and what really actually is our position. So before I come to the point that he raised about the Charvakas and so on, I must make one general point about India, which has actually disappointed me a great deal over the last several decades, which is that our educational system is really basically the one that the British set up. It's still very colonial in character. In spite of more than 60 years now, it's after we became independent. But we have not really taken a square look at the system that we need. It rarely represents an Indian point of view. There may be something about Mahatma Gandhi and a few others. But what has been the traditional Indian viewpoint? What is it that has survived in India? A general appreciation of what happened in India is unfortunately woefully lacking. I've seen even people who are otherwise highly educated, ignorant about what was done. And I can tell you any number of controversies that have occurred in this own country, our own country, where these issues have not been appreciated at all. Let me give you just one instance and I will go on to the other subject. All of you know that last year in the Science Congress in Mumbai, not the one recently in Mysore, but even there it happened. There were sessions on the history of Indic science, and many things were said there, which unfortunately did not represent a reasoned judgment of the situation in India. But as interesting as some of the extraordinary and false claims that were made in that meeting were the extraordinary and false rebuttals that came in the press. So we have here two things, see. In the meeting in Bombay, people came and claimed all kinds of things which we know not to be true. They forgot to claim all those things which are great, are true. And here is the press, which is from one point of view almost as ignorant as the other people who said these things and can't distinguish between what is true there and what is not. And I can give you many examples of that. The claim was made that we had aircraft flying at Mach 10. Certainly not true. And my colleagues at the Institute have made a detailed study of that claim. The claim that the Pythagoras theorem was actually known in India before Pythagoras of the Greeks is true. There's no doubt about it. In fact, there's no reason why it should be attributed to Pythagoras at all, because he never wrote anything about it or about its proof. It was only 500 years after he died that somebody started attributing the result to Pythagoras. This is not a Hindutva view. This is the view of very learned scholars at Stanford and in Germany. They said that Indians had no plastic surgery. Not true. There was, actually. And I have sort of gone through all of that and produced the original verses from Sushruta where it said, and what is more, as late as 200 years ago, the British learned how to put your nose back if somebody had cut it off, largely from the Indians. Now, the point here is that these are not controversial issues among scholars at all, but this knowledge has not seeped into the minds of a large number of our people. I keep meeting young people very often, and I talk to them about what I think happened in India, in terms of science and technology in particular. What is being misrepresented there by exaggerated claims, and what is actually more important to what has happened in the world than we assess. Both things are there. We are downrating. You see, take for example the numeral system. Everybody knows that the numeral system came from here, and it's acknowledged by the whole world. But it stops there. It stops there as if some Indian found some trick about numbers, writing numbers, and that was very influential. It's widely accepted, but it stops there. It does not. It doesn't stop there at all. It is a fact that actually this number system changed our conception, the world's conception of mathematics. It changed the conception of what mathematics was in Europe. The mathematics that we attribute to Europe and that we learn in school and college here is the mathematics, apart from Euclid, that was triggered by the ideas about numbers and algebra and equations that went from India to Europe. And if anybody is interested, you please send me an email. I'll actually send you why I believe that. But the young people, going back to the young people, they're very curious to know what is the truth in all of this. They're bombarded by conflicting views, and they have no idea which is right and which is wrong. And when I talk to them, what I find out is that there's a hunger there for knowledge, which our educational system ought to be provided for, but is not. And I think that this is actually a great weakness in India. So people grow up and in fact get highly educated in some specialization, but have no general view of what happened in India, what its impact on the rest of the world was. We know what the impact of Western science on our world has been, but the rest of the world, but ourselves, we ourselves do not know it. So I think that it's very important to take a very close and critical look at what's happening, what has happened in Indian science and in technology. The debate with the West of the kind that has to be conducted starts with one big disadvantage, and that is the words. We have to translate words. I see this every day in the newspapers when things come out in English, discussing concepts which are really Indian and for which there is no truly precise translation in English. It's the same way the other way around too, from English to our own language. Right from such common words that you hear every day, religion, communal, secular, democracy, these words have no Indian equivalents, because those were not the concepts which drove our civilization. Our civilization was driven more like concepts like dharma and knowledge, jnana. And of course, there were other things too. It was not, there was no politics or economics. There was Kautilya, for example. But when you start translating these concepts from one language to another, the debate gets confused. So one of the major suggestions that I'm going to make to all of those who are interested in these issues, is that when you write something in English, keep the verbs and possibly the adjectives from the language, but some key nouns must really be taken, even adjectives perhaps, must be taken from our own language and used as such without translating them into English. We should Sanskritize or Indicize English spoken in India, written about in India, and not fall a victim to arguing about concepts which are alien to our civilization, where in fact the view that has been taken in our civilization is actually, in my view, still superior. Let me just give you one example. Well, I don't know, there are people speaking many different languages here. What is the word for religion in India? Well, what is the word for secularism in India? Well, for secularism in India, the official translation is Sarva Dharma Nirapeksha. Well, first of all, it uses the word dharma there. Dharma is seen as equivalent to religion. Dharma in India is not equivalent to religion at all. It transcends religion. Similarly, what is the word for religion? Well, in Kannada, I went to a school long ago where Kannada was actually still widely spoken, I must say. And we all read Kannada books. What is the Kannada word for religion? It is Mata. And what is Mata today? Mata is the vote you give in that poll. Okay? When they count that, they say so many Mata. But there is a connection there. Mata is a view. Religion is not just a view, it's much more than that in the Western languages. Why do we say Mata? Because we instinctively accept different Matas. Just as you accept different Matas as possible when you go to vote, India accepts different religious views as natural, is not unnatural. This is a view which is very different from what's been held in other, especially in Western civilization. It is incidentally, by and large, an Eastern view. Not only in India, even if you go to China and Japan, it's very hard to pinpoint what the religion is. One Japanese friend of mine always used to say that he was born like a Shinto, he was married like a Christian, and he would die like a Buddhist. So what is the religion? What is this religion? What is my religion? I don't know, he said. You pick. I want to come back to the question that Rajiv raised about the Charvakas and about science in India. Once again, I think there's great confusion here. The methods that were used for science in India were not the same as what the Greeks adopted. At first, when I first started my studies, I thought this was something that the Indians didn't know about. As I continued my studies, I slowly discovered that although it was not called the Greek view, that view was rejected after consideration. For example, the Indian objection always was to Euclid. They never argued with Euclid or the Greeks. But if you go to that method, well, you see it's based on hypotheses. And we don't know, the hypothesis may be right or wrong. In other words, how do you know that the axioms are right? You say, I do this axiom, and I go by two-valued logic to the conclusion. And they would say, well, how do you know that logic is two-valued? How do you know that your axioms are correct? That view would have been revolutionary even 100 years ago. But in the West, as with the other subjects that he mentioned, the view is changing around now. And people see that you can't rely entirely on axioms. And that that may not necessarily be the best way to go about doing your science. In India, our scientific reasoning in general, always put observation or pratyaksha first. The Charvakas said only pratyaksha. Okay. But the systems which came after them, like the Sankhyas, Yoga, Nyaya, Vaisheshika, Nyaya for example, Vaisheshika and so on, total of six systems. See, in India there's not a single view. It is a civilization, it's not a religion, it's not one nation. It is a civilization trying, if you want to put it that way, to be a civilizational state in a world which has been very intrusive. India has not been intrusive in the rest of the world, but the rest of the world has been intrusive here. So we have been trying to make a civilizational state out of an ancient civilization, one of only two which have survived now for 4,000 or 5,000 years, no other in the world. And I see that our friend, Mr. Pollock, when he talks about civilization and nation, he talks about civilizations which has come out of nations. Well, but the concept of nation is only 150 years old, and it's entirely European. We ourselves have fallen prey to it. We always think of India as a nation. India is not a nation. India is actually a civilization. The Supreme Court understands that, but our politicians and our journalists still don't understand that. We are, however, a civilizational state. And the concept of a civilizational state is quite different from the concept of a European nation state. Nation state has a border. It has a language. It has a religion. Well, in India, there's no sharp border. There's no one language, and there's no one religion. So going back to this issue, the reason that the Charvakas eventually failed to gain acceptance in India is that they depended only on observation, pratyaksha. The general argument in India was, okay, pratyaksha is okay, it's very necessary, important. It's the most important evidence on which you can base your reasoning. But if you limited yourself to pratyaksha, you cannot argue about the past, you cannot predict the future. How can you predict the future? How can you predict the position of that planet? If I said I am only doing it by observation, observation is necessary but not sufficient. This view turned out to be so successful in India that the Charvakas were forgotten. They're there still, and as he said, they were smart people, it's not that they were stupid. But the view slowly began to be rejected. But even then, observation and pratyaksha were the first. And that was true among the scientists and among the spiritualists. The spiritualists began with observation, jnana, their own experience, anubhava, as very important. And the scientists started there. The philosophers started there, but went on to include, first of all, what's been called anumana in India. For those Kannadigas who always think of anumana as suspicion, I must emphasize that anumana is a technical Sanskrit word. The meaning there is not suspicion. The meaning is inference, okay? But in that word inference, two things are mixed. It's a reasoning process. But it's not a reasoning process where you arrive at the absolute truth. You may not. Inference may not be absolute truth. But it helps you predict the future. It helps you understand the past. From this point of view, the Indian approach to science and knowledge was very practical. I say that because, once again, all these new people, this, what do you call them, this new group in the United States, which is, which is trying to be the dispenser of knowledge of India to us, that group does not realize that the Indian view of many of these things was extremely practical. Now, when I say that, people are at first surprised. There was one thing in India, even in Indian philosophy, look at the old books. There is an argument always. And the argument can even be between the Shishya and the Guru. And the Shishya was perfectly justified in asking the Guru, tell me why I should do this. The Guru had to justify why he had to study that subject. Let me compare that with an instance from Euclid. Euclid teaches geometry. He taught geometry like a coaching class today. You had to come there and pay fees, and you could be his student, and he taught you geometry. So there's one student, there's a story. There's one student who comes there, and at the end of the day, he says, Mr. Euclid, what's the good of all this? And you know what Euclid does? He doesn't answer that question. He calls his slave and says, this man asked me what geometry is good for. Return his money to him and send him away. I don't want to talk to him again. So you can see how different these views are. So reason was never banished in India, even on adhyatmic matters. That we must understand. Recently, a friend of mine gave me a copy of Gaudapada. Now, I had heard a great deal about Gaudapada and read a little bit about him, but I had never actually seen his work, and so I started reading it. What fascinated me was it was in four chapters. The first chapter is basically the Vedic view. What do Vedas say? It sets it all down. But the interesting begins in the second chapter. In the second chapter, it says, Well, I've told you in the first chapter what the Vedic view is. Now, from now on, I'm not going to depend on the Vedas at all. I'm going to depend on pure reason. If you don't like the Vedas, that's a different matter. But now my argument is pure reason. And I'm going to describe to you in the next three chapters. It's basically what you may call a discourse on an Advaitic view, an Advaitic philosophy, before Shankara, incidentally. He was actually Shankara's guru. So, in some sense. So, reason and religion, or spirituality, were not beyond reason. Our views of those things have been very different. So, the next three chapters are about a reason view of what the Advaitic position is. If you look at science, the man who first said in science that inference is also important was Charaka. Charaka said, we can't do it. Observation is very important, but it's not enough. We must actually go by inference. We must use reason. And we must use reason, and we must convince other people. We must convince other skilled doctors that we have actually a cure for the disease. Without convincing other people, you can't say this is science yet. Well, that's a very good definition of science, and in some sense valid even today, as it was at that time. So whether you took our spiritual text, whether you took science, whether you took mathematics, it was A, based on evidence, B, based on reasoning, although the reasoning was not exactly the same as in Greece and Europe, based on a consensus, which is very much the position today in the world. And so it's very hard. I find it very hard to say that our systems were not rational. And it's actually not even difficult to find this out. You only have to read the Aryabhatiya or Brahmagupta. Brahmagupta is a different case. I don't want to mention Brahmagupta system. You have to read the Aryabhatiya to find this out. So, my time is up and I actually have to be going. What I would like to suggest is that it's very important for us to be able to take part in these discourses, to put the Indian position correctly, but critically, not without arguments among ourselves. It's important that this must be a part of our educational system. It's important that our educational system must be changed so that science, the humanities, social sciences, arts are all in the same campus. We have very few in universities now. The universities were supposed to do it, and the universities which used to do it once upon a time are no longer in the same position. I'm a great advocate in this country of setting up new universities called Indian National Universities. We set up IITs, we set up IISc, we set up NITs and all kinds of things. We need some national Indian universities where the Indian view is common knowledge among all the students who go there. This is not to say that things should not be criticized. Criticism is as old a component of thought in India as it is anywhere else in the world, perhaps more. You see, when people talk about Hindu views or Indian views, but they make a distinction between those and Buddhist views. Well, that's really totally wrong. That's why I like to use the word Indic. Buddhist is as Indic as what the foreigners have called Hinduism. We did not give that name. It was given by foreigners. And the different philosophies that we have, the wide variety of them, Indic is not one. It is many. It is very diverse. It's as diverse as our linguistic environment in this country. Just as we are used to the language changing, if you go 100 kilometers, you must also be used to the philosophy changing if you go to a different community. So we must understand this diversity in our country, but critically look at them. There's too much uncritical acclamation of false achievements, just as there is an inadequate appreciation of the true achievements. We've got it all wrong, and I think that it's very important for us to do it. It requires a big effort, and in such an effort, I think people like Rajiv Malhotra are playing a pioneering role. They're pointing out what other people are saying, what actually has happened, and what we really need to do. And I think that you're doing a great service to India. Thank you very much.
And I just want to thank Roddam. He has an appointment. He has to leave. So we're twice blessed. We have one chief guest coming and one going. Thank you so much.
So I beg your leave, I'm sorry.
Yes, thank you.
Thanks, leave, I'm sorry.
Thank you so much.
Folks, I'm happy to be here finally. My flight was taking off, then they aborted the flight, so we had to go back, recheck the engine, and come back from Bombay. Took some time. I think Rajiv has been raising certain fundamental issues for quite some time, which all of us need to debate in this country. And the fundamental issues are, should civilizations protect their identity and retain their identity? Now, we are a very old civilization. It may go back thousands of years. We have very much to be proud of. Should we retain what our heritage is and invest in that? And why should we do it? Now let's look towards the West. In Europe, they claim that the Western civilization civilized the world, and they invested heavily, and they go back to the Greek tradition. Greek, Rome, they forget the Dark Ages, then the Renaissance and the Enlightenment, and they claim a unique place in world civilization and the mastery of this planet, because they say we are the ones who made civilization what it is, and they write about it, and they write about us, they write about the Chinese and the Japanese, and say that we are the superior civilization. It's a white man's burden. But they preserve the Greek classics. They have a lot of universities which reinterpret the Greek classics from time to time. They translate the Greek classics, the Roman classics, into English and various languages, European languages. And they have debates, conclaves, and they have mastery over the civilization. And they have retained their identity as Europeans, inheritance of Western civilization. Something called the Western civilization. And they interpret our civilization, in their view, what Rajiv keeps saying, Purva-paksha, and they propagate their point of view to clearly demonstrate their mastery, to say that they're the originators of science and technology and everything else. So they have preserved. And they claim they're the center of the world. China, a very old civilization, in the Cultural Revolution, destroyed everything that was of the past. We know what Mao did, right? In the Cultural Civilization, Cultural Revolution, the intellectuals are put back to the field to plow and for agriculture. And anybody civilized, educated, were banned, are put in the field to work, are sentenced to hard labor, because they wanted a break with the past. Now suddenly, when China has become the largest economy in the world, they want to rediscover the heritage. The Chinese took English names. You go to China, you talk to young people, they got two names, a Chinese name and an Indian name. A Chinese name and an English name. And they felt that they were deprived and they want to demonstrate superiority, so did that. Now, China has become rich. China is going back and trying to rediscover its roots I think an American author, I don't know his name, has written a 14-volume book, Why China is the Heart of the World Civilization, and all the great discourse of the old world happened in China. And now they're claiming the heritage, and many scholars in the West are mimicking the same thing, talking the same thing, and glorifying China. And in China, the billionaires are going back, buying those old Ming vases and all the artifacts which have been taken away, especially after the sack of the Summer Palace in 1864. We all know Summer Palace was the height of human civilization, 1 square kilometer of pleasure and beauty, which was sacked by the European forces in 1864 in the Opium Wars. And all the artifacts are distributed, now they're buying them back and putting them in their museums. They're opening museums. They're giving pride to Chinese to say we are Chinese. And if you talk to young Chinese, they're they got a lot of pride and very proud of the country. They think they're patriots and they march in the streets every time they have an anniversary of the Nanjing massacre. I think Nanjing, you know, killing in 1933 or around that time. The Chinese have done it. The Arabs are doing it. I think suddenly we are hearing about the Islamic civilization's great achievements in science and technology, 11th, 12th, 13th century. Books are being written. Authors are being commissioned. A lot of things are happening. And suddenly the upsurge. And everywhere is that everything of science and discovery is in the Quran. And the point is, what's the Quran and say, it's already been said. Everything has been said. So they're doing it to send the message that we are not Bedus. We are not tribals. We are a great civilization. We have many things to be proud of. And of course, we fell into bad ways. The Crusades happened. But all these things happen. They're doing it. So what is India doing? We're declining our civilization. You say you are a Hindu or Indian and talk about something, you are communal. It's the only country where you talk about yourself and civilization, you're deemed communal. I don't know what this word communal means. And you are not secular. The only secular people on the planet are the polytheistic people. If you're polytheistic, by nature you're secular. Because polytheism is many paths, no single path. In monotheism, you have one single path, one single God, one way to go to heaven, and you don't go to heaven. A friend of mine asked a Protestant in America, because he was trying to tell him about many things. He said, will Gandhiji go to heaven? Gandhiji will not go to heaven, according, because he's not baptized. He's not going to heaven. But a terrorist who does jihad will go to heaven. Buddha will not go to heaven. Buddha is not baptized. Of course, Buddha creates his own heaven, right? Shankara will create his own heaven. But the point I'm trying to say is, monotheism by its very nature is restricted. It's only the age of enlightenment and the suppression of church and state which made Christianity what it is today, where there's a greater amount of freedom. Or you know what happened in the Dark Ages. Islam has not had a social revolution to create the distance between religion and the person. And I think that is having its ramifications in all the jihadis in this very bad interpretation of the Quran now. Quran is a religion of peace in many ways. It is true. But it also has verses which talk about how to treat the kafir. There are verses in the Bible, in the Torah, how to treat others. There are verses in Manusmriti, how to teach people who listen to the Vedas, right? We all know that. But we don't activate that. We ignore that. Why do we ignore that? Because they were creation of a particular time and space, and they're not very relevant today. We take the good things and say all the things should go away. And Christianity has done that. Islam has not done that. So we have the IS, we have the jihadis who interpret, and they're all supposed to be good Islamists. And they're the ones who are going to go to heaven. So the monotheism creates a single path, whereas polytheism by its very nature creates multiple paths. And in polytheism, even an atheist has got space. Atheism is part of it. So which kind of a social structure or a religion provides for an atheist to be a full member of society? So we can never be communal. The idea of communalism and what it is I don't know what it is. So now, who should preserve a civilization's heritage? Who should preserve it? And the question we got to ask, and that's what my friend Rajiv is asking, who should preserve it? The people to whom the civilization belongs should preserve it. They must invest. They must have scholars. They must have literature. They must have translation. They must have universities which do research. And we talk about it. Not to say Mera Bharat Mahan and all this thing, flying saucers and all that. You know, we know they're all figments of somebody's imagination. But the good things about mathematics, about science, about ethics, about metallurgy, all the good things which are there have to be preserved and spoken about, because they give us an identity. Now our children don't speak our languages. Our children don't speak Kannada, Hindi, Konkani or whatever it is. They speak English. And when they speak English, what are they going to teach them as content in your own civilization? The cuisines are all McDonald's and, you know, what is Friday? Good Friday or something like that, right? TGI Friday, okay. They got all this stuff, pizzas, gizzas and all that, right? I thought pizzas are banned now in the last 2 years. But, you know, our own food, our own cuisine is so rich, we're not passing on. Our lullabies, I go to Bangalore airport, I see a Kannadiga mother tell this small kid, bah, bah, black sheep. Oh my God. I said, why didn't you say about the nursery rhymes in Kannada? That's beautiful nursery rhymes, right? They're there. How are you going to transmit it? Who has to preserve that? We have to preserve that. It cannot be preserved by outsiders. Now, the greatest, I think, I don't know, I may be wrong, the greatest collection of Sanskrit literature is out of the West. Maybe in Chicago, maybe in Germany, maybe somewhere else. Max Muller has become the global authority about our civilization. And Max Muller, I don't know whether he knew Sanskrit, right? He had a dictionary. The first thing you do is create a dictionary. On the dictionary, you read and you write and interpret what you want. Wendy Dong doesn't know Sanskrit, but she's acknowledged authority about Hinduism. 1.27 billion people's heritage civilization captured by a few individuals who preach a particular way, and we're keeping quiet. What kind of a country is this? What kind of a people are we? Don't we have ... to stand up and put it ourselves? And we have these malcontents going on TV and decrying us for standing up and saying, that's not right. And why are we so tolerant? It's because we're so tolerant. There's growing tolerance. Not intolerance, there's growing tolerance in this country. Growing tolerance. Tolerance to decrying yourself.
Very good.
Tolerance to giving up your past. Tolerance to others, to letting others dominate your discourse and your civilization. Tolerance to giving up your heritage, giving up everything that is you, in your blood, in your, in the way you live, in the way you dress. Everything is going. So we have to preserve it ourselves. And Rajiv is raising that point. To me, that's fundamental. And then, what have we lost? We lost a lot. We lost control of our lives. We lost control of our civilization. We lost control of our thinking. All these people, some schools of Western thought, like Wendy or somebody else, he's very opposed to Sheldon Pollock. I know I'm a little bit more softer. Whatever it is, doesn't matter. But, you know, they're writing in their culture, their milieu, which is right. There's nothing wrong. If we are foolish and we are stupid, we can't blame somebody else. Because he's writing to control us, to dominate us intellectually, tell you we know more about you and this is the way it is. And we have people like Ananya, Vajpayee and others going writing silly articles in the Hindu. About all those Sanskrit scholars in Banaras for hundreds of years preserving the culture. Why the misogynists and the bad people. And she going to this place, wonderful place wherever she goes with Wendy. He is the greatest creator and the voice of Sanskrit. And we keep quiet. So we're losing ourselves, we're losing our own culture. All the people in this room are part of this transition culture. You know Sanskrit, you know many things, but our children don't. So what is going to happen 30 years from now? We're going to put up a generation which does not know what India is. And we're going to put up a generation when we're going to become the third largest economy in the world. Maybe second largest economy in the world. This is going to be a rich country in 2030. We're going to be $8 to $10 trillion. And we're growing pretty fast. And when we grow pretty fast, the end result is we're not sure of what we are. I think it's an important thing that we need to understand. And then, what India should do and why? What should India do? We should take control of our civilizational discourse. We should have many scholars who will research, who will write independently. There is no mumbo jumbo. It's all based upon, facts. It's all based upon what you want to do. It's all based upon data. It's all based upon interpretation. And you can be critical to whatever degree you want. There is no one school of thought in India. We know that. We're a polytheistic people. So we need our own scholars to write, to debate, to create. We need our universities to have rich departments of comparative religion like other people have. The US has many universities of comparative religion. Harvard has it. Stanford has it. Everybody has it. Oxford has it. Cambridge has it. But we don't have it. When the British were there, we had it. We had a Sanskrit college in Banaras. Banaras Hindu University got funding. But after it became independent, suddenly we became secular. Secularism doesn't mean the government does not invest in our past in religious studies. Secularism means the government does not promote any religion. So if you have a department of comparative religion in the university, even the Indian Institute of Science, for whatever it's worth, I mean, it is academic work. You do study in academic way to create a point of view. And there has to be public investment. It has to be done by, you know, public money. It has to be done by taxpayers' money to create a vital creation of academics and scholars who can debate and carry on and reinterpret. And that's very, very important. And next, we need our billionaires to fund schools. We got 62 billionaires, $260 billion of value of money they got. They need to put money here. Murthy has done it in Harvard. That's very good. But he needs to do it in Bangalore too. He needs to do it in India too. Let him do it in Harvard. You know, Tata gave $50 million to Harvard University or somewhere, right? I mean, he must do it in India too. Nothing wrong. Do it here. Do it in the world. Do it here. What the Chinese did, they fund universities to make sure their point of view is propagated in the West. We fund universities outside to make sure their point of view is propagated in India. I don't know how perverse you can get. So we lost control. So we give our money because we want to be seen as the white man's equal. I'm sorry I'm making this statement. I apologize. But I feel hurt. It's okay to do it and say, these are the conditions we want our civilization to be propagated. We want our scholars to come and to make sure that people understand their views, right? That's the way we are. We have to promote ourselves. This is marketing. This is a consumer world. Nobody is going to market your point of view, right? We want to teach Balaji, who has never come to India, born in the US or something, a good techie, what an Indian truly is, right? We got to teach him. So we need our own stuff. So we need our billionaires to fund all this. We need people to come and to study it and create jobs for people who come out of them, so they're scholars, so we keep it alive. Now, why is Rajiv important? Why is Rajiv important? Because Rajiv realized this 20, 25 years ago. And Rajiv has fought the battle. Rajiv has been ostracized. Rajiv has written a variety of books with his own money, with his own time, to tell us, hey guys, you're losing something which is very valuable to you. You're using your soul. You're losing your soul, and it's not going to come back. It takes time to build a soul. You got a lot of soul, hundreds of years of work. You know, whenever I go to do my Shraddha for my father, when I sit down and do it for my father, we do the Pindadan and all that, right? I always think of the long line of people who sacrificed and did many things so I could come into the world and be what I am. I am what I am because the investment they have made in creating a society, keeping society alive, creating culture. Right? And by this, I pay homage to their souls. I'm a long line, it's a continuum, and I must pass it on. And I'm not passing it on. I must pass on my heritage, the good and the bad, and allow them to debate. But we're not doing it. The disconnection is happening. We're giving up. Is it good to have traditions? Each one of us has to make our own judgment. I'm not saying it's good or bad. You have to make your own judgment because it's important for you to understand your identity, what you want to preserve, what it is. Yes, there are many good things and bad things. There's a caste structure that's going away. In fact, Ashutosh Vasne told me just in a breakfast this week, he said, caste is morphing into a lobby. If you look back to caste in 1920, there were no SCST, there were no OBC. There were many, many multiple castes. And each caste was fighting to create superiority. Even the Brahmin community, you got Drivedi, Chaturvedi, Trivedi, all the Vedis, right? Saying, I'm bigger than you, right? Is there a structure, power structure? Now what has happened? Politicians have created structures like SCST to create a lobby to get things for themselves. Then the OBC lobby, there's nothing like an OBC. They're only caste. They collect them together and each one has a lobby. And that's fantastic because a social structure has morphed into an economic structure or a political structure. And that means the old disparities will go away. And that's very good. Caste is morphed into something else that may be good or bad. Now, Rajiv has studied this, written about it, is talking about it. So Rajiv is important to me and Rajiv should be important to all of us. And we have to support him and through Rajiv create a group of academics who can carry this forward. And why Sanskrit? Why should he study Sanskrit? Many people on the left say Sanskrit is dead. I think even Sheldon Pollock has said Sanskrit is dead, right? Bendy has said Sanskrit is dead. It's all dead language. Ananya writes Sanskrit is dead. I don't want to give glory to Ananya by repeating it, but I feel very offended by the article she wrote in the Hindu. I wish many of you look at it and read it and get sufficiently angry and have a blood boil to keep on writing rejoinders. I mean, it's disparaging, insulting, and humiliating that a small tweet writes such things about scholars who spend their whole lives on doing big things. Why Sanskrit? Because our content is in Sanskrit, the original content in Sanskrit. Why Greek? Why Latin? Even now in the Vatican, the liturgy is in Latin. They keep it alive. Why is that? because the original content is there. And in translation, much is lost. And in Sanskrit, a beautiful language, in the intonation, new meanings arise. That's what I'm told. In the intonation, new meanings arise. And if you don't have the proper intonation, the meanings get lost. It morphs into something else. And the intonation is the way to keep it alive and interpret in a particular manner. My Kannada professor, Venkatesh Murthy, who's a poet, was speaking in Hegodu, where I once went. I lost my way there, went there, spent 3 days. And he's saying, why are there multiple Ramayanas and Mahabharatas in India? He said, there are multiple Ramayanas because Ramayana is a great epic. It's a story with a lot of values and meanings. And he says, each generation in his own genius to reinterpret the Mahabharata and the Ramayana in his own context, because the context changes. Was Rama here right in banishing Sita? Now with woman's lib and all, is not right. You can't say she's right. But he did in a particular milieu, so now we got to reinterpret. Was Rama a god who was everything? Or Rama a great human being? We got to reinterpret. So every society, every generation rewrites Ramayana in his own way. And there are multiple points of view. But to me, the principle of free thought, the principle of interpreting, the principle of not having anything so sacred that is bound in time and fixed in time and nobody shall move one single word. That principle of freedom is the greatest freedom India has given to the world. The freedom to critique your own religion, to reinterpret, to rewrite, and to say some things that you want. You can make Rama into a Ravana, Ravana into a Rama, it doesn't matter. Because they're reinterpreting. That intellectual freedom is the fountain of civilization. And that is what has kept our civilization alive. And that's why all of us are here. All of us are here to read Rajiv's book, to debate, to fight. And there can be no violence in this country when we debate and we don't disagree. We disagree vehemently. It's all right. Even disagreement is part of our culture. And that's very important. So Sanskrit is a content. Sanskrit is an operating system. It's an open system. Indian civilization is an open system. Sanskrit is an open system. You can add on it. And it is a structured system so that it carries on and the meaning doesn't change. Like code doesn't change, right? It's logical. So it's very logical. So we must learn Sanskrit. And you must have Sanskrit scholars. And you must go to the originals. From the originals, you must reinterpret every generation. Like Greek is kept alive, Latin is kept alive, even though it's public investment. And only in doing that, can we keep it alive? Does it add meaning to us? Because when we read the old text, understand all this, we understand why we behave in a particular way. Why we do things in a particular way. Many of us don't know why it happens. Or how it happens, right? And if you do that, we understand our place in the world. We understand the intersection. I've been reading books now which say that in Central Asia, there's a very large Buddhist civilization. There are old temples there in Central Asia, Kyrgyzstan, all the stans, huge temples. And those people are very, very, let's say, more open than the Arabs. And even there in the Middle East, there were temples. So we don't know our own history, how far our civilization spread. And there's a book in the book which says that in Armenia, there was a Hindu community in the 13th century. In Mitra. And you know, the Iranian Zoroastrian civilization, our civilization, were mixed. Because they all worship Indra. So we don't know all this stuff. We don't know all the things that happened. And we need to know it because that history will tell us what our place in. And that's why we got to learn Sanskrit. And Sanskrit has to be kept alive. And Sanskrit is not a dead language. It's a content, it's an operating system. And it should not die. Because Sanskrit dies, our soul dies. We die. We become rootless. And that is very important for us. So, I just want to say, this is my interpretation about what Rajiv has written. Thank you. I don't know whether he agrees with me, because I want to have a very broad interpretation. There are many things written about content, about the challenges, and many things people have done, and why we have to reclaim. I agree with most things. Some I will differ, is my friend. So thank you very much for listening to me, and I'm very happy to be here just to share some views with you. Thank you very much.
When there was no scientific objective instruments, you know. So today, you say it's a new reality that we'll have to respond to, that we'll have to explain, you know, because subjective science by itself is verifiable. They are injective in nature. And you do the experiment.
Yeah, let me respond to that. So let me just clarify. Charvak 1.0 is the earlier Charvak who totally dismissed the Vedas and anything spiritual and transcendental. Charvak 2.0 also like that. The Sheldon Pollocks of the world completely dismiss Vedic Shruti. They are materialists in the sense that the material world, so the Charvaks in that sense, they dismiss the Vedic and they look at the material world. But they are worse in the sense, worse than the previous ones, because they also accuse the spiritual tradition of having human rights violations, of being toxic, poisonous, and they look at it through political motives that the whole thing was political exploitation. The earlier Charvaks took a metaphysical stand, but they did not turn into some global, kind of a mobilization of human rights with funding from Ford Foundation and all that. Whereas these today's Charvaks are all part of a global nexus for social intervention. So they're not just taking a metaphysical view like the previous Charvaks, they're doing that also. But on top of that, they're interventionists in social science, in a sense, social sense. That's why the Charvak 2.4 is more dangerous today. And they've also recruited, and there are global nexus there also. Now, as far as empiricism is concerned, the Charvak 1.0 and the Charvak 2.0 both dismiss the inner sciences, the adhyatmic, what you're talking about, the adhyatma vidya, they dismiss that. So I'm proposing a Charvak 3.0 who is very, very interested in the empirical science, because that is how progress has been made in the last few hundred years, but who also respects the inner science. So what you are talking about, that first person empiricism, which is verifiable, and the third person empiricism, which is normally considered the objective reality, is verifiable. Both should be admissible. And that is what I am proposing.
And you are also saying they're correlated in some sense.
And the first person can be sometimes verified by the third person. Or at least check, not complete proof, but it can be correlated. Thank you. Thank you.
सर रिसेंटली मैंने एक एंशियंट साइंस के ऊपर एक कॉन्फ्रेंस अटेंड की थी जो पुणे में थी एस्ट्रा 2016 वहां पर आर चिदम्बरम भी आए थे प्रिंसिपल साइंटिफिक एडवाइजर टू प्राइम मिनिस्टर भी एवरीबडी वाज सेइंग कि हमको अपनी एंशियंट साइंस को रिवाइव करना है मेडिसिन एग्रीकल्चर एक्सेट्रा एक्सेट्रा यहाँ भी ऐसा ही कुछ है कि हमको अपनी एंशियंट साइंस को जो सोल है वो संस्कृत में लिखी हुई है उसको तो सर मेरा क्वेश्चन बस ये है कि बहुत सालों से मैं सुन रहा हूँ कि ऐसा करना है लेकिन किस क्योंकि एक आदमी से तो होगा नहीं है पूरा इंडिया को बहुत सारे जो पद किस पद पर बैठे व्यक्ति या व्यक्तियों को क्या करना है जिससे कि ये हो
सो द क्वेश्चन इज वी ऑल टॉक अबाउट रिवाइवल ऑफ इंडियन साइंस एंड सो ऑन हु इज टू डू इट वी कीप टॉकिंग अबाउट इट And I'd like Mohandas's view also. I think government has a role in this. I mean, government has a role. I mean, I have done all I can. We started a project of putting 20 volumes on history of Indian science and technology. We have done 10 already. 10 volumes are already published. That Deccan College conference, I was supposed to give an address there, but I was busy trying to fight the battles to get my book out. The book went many times to the printer, and then there would be some protest or something and it would not happen. And then I'd go back and fight. So I didn't want to make any noise until I had a few thousand copies in our possession, which we now do. So we won the first battle of Sanskrit by getting the book out. And yeah, so that's why I didn't go to that conference, because it was more important to be in Delhi, fight, make sure this happens, you know. So I'm aware of that conference. Now that's a very good thing that is happening. More and more conferences happening, awareness spreading. But you know, they have to create some funding, they have to create a department. So when you are studying mathematics, you should be studying the history of Indian mathematics as part of that. When you are studying chemistry, when you are studying medicine, when you go to AIMS and study medicine, you should study the history of Indian contributions. Every profession, it should not be that Sanskrit department is a separate thing. It should be separate, but then the particular contribution of our Sanskriti in a certain discipline should be part of that discipline also. ये तो एचआरडी का काम है ना दिस इज द जॉब एचआरडी we can keep discussing. Maybe one day somebody will listen.
And my next question is, jaise aapne kaha ki knowledge, now knowledge is controlled by outsiders. Ab ye general question hai, ancient science ke upar nahi hai. IIT Bangalore mein padha hu, main BRC se hu. Wahan par bhi bahut sare log hame jaisa dekha hai, yadi mera paper Nature mein publish ho jata hai, to I'm very happy.
Yes.
Main sochta hu, maan le ki Nature ka wo hota, referee. To wahan par mere paas paper aaya, mere paas pure world ki knowledge hai. वर्ल्ड से जितना भी नॉलेज आ रहा है वो मेरे पास आ रहा है. एवरीबॉडी इज टाइपिंग एंड सेंडिंग टू मी. उसके बाद क्या है कि मैं रिजेक्ट भी कर सकता हूं, उसे दोबारा भी भेज सकता हूं, तो उनके पास तो एक बहुत अच्छा नॉलेज सोर्स क्रिएट हो रहा है. तो बेसिकली तो सर ये तो हम अपने
दिस ही इज मेकिंग अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट दैट ऑल द प्रेस्टीजियस जर्नल्स वेयर एवरीबॉडी इन इंडिया वांट टू सेंड देयर पेपर बिकॉज़ इफ वंस इट गेट्स पब्लिश्ड इन दिस वेस्टर्न जर्नल देन हिज करियर इज मेड. सो द रेफरी हु इज डिसाइडिंग which one to publish, which one not to publish, sending it back with his comments, he gets to suck all the knowledge of everybody. Whether even if out of 10 papers he selects one, the other 9 he gets to learn their knowledge.
Yes.
Huh? And he can use it. So this is an amazing control of journals and having the reviewer in your in somebody's particular ideology and somebody's civilization means that he's the clearinghouse to legitimize everybody. Who gets through, who doesn't get through, he's the gatekeeper. And therefore, he accumulates knowledge of everybody just for free.
And he uses it for their benefit.
Yeah. So this is the importance. Who controls the journals? Who controls the dissertations? Who controls the publishing houses? Prestigious. I am publishing this through a British publishing house owned by Murdoch, HarperCollins. And Penguin is owned by the Americans. So these two control the international publishing scene. Now, why do I do it? I can get this printed anywhere. Manipal Press, very good press. He's part of the Manipal, he's the chairman of the Manipal group. So they are one of the finest presses. They are the ones who printed it. I got a quote, I could also get it printed. But if I got it printed from and published from a small press, it would not be in the airport shops because they don't have clout. Only these big publishers have clout to put it in prestigious airport shops and other places. So an author like me has to go with them. So this is how the whole system of distribution of knowledge, the channels of knowledge distribution are controlled by certain people. So all the producers have to go and beg them and be with them and all that, right? Similarly, these literary festivals like Jaipur and so on, they decide, okay, now they did not want my book. I don't give no reason. They did not include it. The festival is starting in 3-4 days. But people I criticize who are on the other side, they've been felicitated for the last 8-9 years, every year one after the other. So it's a one-sided thing. And their attitude is, well, it's our festival. You can do what you want. It's not, we don't have to give any answer. So these channels, media is another channel. Media is also biased and they don't owe any explanation. They never invite. I have never been reviewed. This is my 5th book. No book has been reviewed in any mainstream media ever. The only time they mention me is to attack me personally. So it's very surprising. The Hindu, for example, the Hindu newspaper, which should actually be called the anti-Hindu, you know, yeah. Every time a book has been out, we always send all these guys and they ignore it. Suddenly, they produce a huge article against me, attacking me for personal things, not arguing about the content, the philosophy, the principles, the substance of the book, but trying to insinuate all kinds of things against me, as if I'm a well-known person to their readers, but they have never even mentioned me in the past. So I'm suddenly important when it's time to attack, and when my book is out, I'm not important enough to even review it. I told them you should review even if you give a negative review. At least review, acknowledge the book exists, you know. This is how biased things are. I don't know, but let's ask what do you feel is the solution?
मैं समझता हूँ कि सॉल्यूशन ये हो सकता है कि जो कोई जैसे बालाजी है, बालाजी एक पोर्टल करेगा जहाँ की जो नेचर को भेजा गया लेकिन पब्लिश नहीं हुआ उधर पब्लिश होगा.
वेरी गुड आइडिया.
और उसमें टैक्सोनॉमी डालेगा.
वेरी गुड आइडिया.
और जैसे जैसे वो पब्लिश होगा सारे के सारे स्कॉलर्स आपके जैसे सब लोग इधर जाकर उधर देखेंगे और उसके और उसका एक मूवमेंट होगा. जैसा ट्विटर में है अभी मीडिया का कंट्रोल चले गया क्योंकि हम सब लोग मीडिया बन गए.
ट्विटर में सब लोग हैं, ट्विटर के बिना अटैक करते हैं, लिखते हैं, और जो अभी कॉलेज से बाहर आ रहे नवयुवक बाहर आ रहे वो सब लोग अभी ट्विटर पर ही न्यूज मिलता है उनको, उनको पेपर नहीं पढ़ते, टीवी नहीं देखते, और बोलते मैं टीवी नहीं देखता हूँ, पेपर नहीं पढ़ता हूँ, लेकिन सब इंफॉर्मेशन है। सो टेक्नोलॉजी से कर सकते हैं, अगर बालाजी महाराज मन करे, उनके पास पैसा है, टेक्नोलॉजी है, ये हो सकता है।
सो बालाजी, नाउ इट्स योर रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी। Yeah, I mean, we need media channels. Like there's a history channel in the US doing very well. We should have an itihas channel or something like that, which talk, there are so many topics you could make 1,000 documentaries on all kind of Indian narrative, Indian history of science, industries, all kind of things could be there. But you know, our people who got, people who are in the media have to be imaginative. I think it would also be commercially successful. It will take investment to do all this. So we need, these are, the consumer wants it, the public wants it. The mere fact there's so many people and wherever we go, people are looking for this. But the supply of these kind of things has not yet happened. It bothers me also, and bothers you also, I'm sure.
Are
happening. Certain things are happening. For instance, Ayurveda is being promoted. It's a good example. Ayurveda is being promoted, it is helping people. Now Baba Ramdev is giving it a bigger push. He is making it very neighborhood, go to the neighborhood store and buy some things and all that. You know, his
billionaire,
someone told me that his consumer goods, he's number three consumer goods, like oil and toothpaste, not easy to dislodge these huge multinationals. With the basically very simple rudimentary grassroots movement, and it works. So local product, Swadeshi product is becoming successful again. So I guess it's a business model. People should try to become Swadeshi and introduce these ideas.
No, I think it's happening because if you look at TV debates today, they're not one-sided anymore like it was 2 years ago. There are multiple views coming up, and the TV producers and the hosts also are now coming around that there are multiple views because they're losing the readership. Every time they criticize something and take one side view, growing intolerance, people throw stones at them and they're losing the readership. Because Twitter is there, social media is there. The key, what is the key? The key is for all the people who believe in one views to stand up and say and propagate the views and put content and stand up and fight the battle. Now it's very cheap to fight the battle. At least you couldn't fight the battle because you wrote an article in response to somebody, they will not publish it. Now put it on Twitter, put it on Facebook, hundreds of people will see it. Publish it. Don't be abusive. Be rational, data, and publish it. And very soon, if more and more comes, you will overwhelm everybody else. The tide has turned. And society is much more open. So the control for the mind. You see, in India, from the time of Nurul Hasan till today, our institutions in social sciences have been filled with leftists. Because if you're not a leftist, you never got a job for many years. So you drew away the right. I mean, there has to be a balance between the left and the right. History is all something called subaltern studies. Subaltern studies, right? I'm learning these terms. It also means in a particular way of telling you what you are, and they've taken control of your mind. So it's not an open mind. Why? Because the space has been vacated. Swaraja magazine. It's fantastic. We're all investors. They're having a point of view. We need more like that. And people will invest. You start new things, you get people like a Jerry Rao or somebody like that, or Rajiv will start a portal, or Balaji, he can fund it, right, Balaji, after you exit. So now, you know, you need to do all that. The content is important. I think many people should write, and all of you should start writing about news and following it will take shape.
So just to give you an example of what he said, just to give you an example of the power of social media, I was attacked last June. And they made a petition to ban my books. They told the publishers that withdraw his books, ban his books. So really they were trying to prevent this book from coming out because I had announced it in the Thailand conference, created a big anger against the other people, and they wanted to prevent me from having my book out. So they got a lot of signatures, and they got a lot of articles in the newspaper. So we had no response available to us in the newspaper. Hindu criticized me, would not publish my response, Business Standard, all these guys. So we went to social media. They got 250 signatures for their petition, and we put a counter petition and we got 11,000 signatures. Yeah. And many of you and people I addressed this morning in Sanskrit Bharati, many of them were actively involved in helping my signatures, and the Sanskrit University I talked to, you know, yesterday, the Youth Brigade I spoke to the first day in Bangalore, all of them told me, all of them got involved, and so it was grassroots movement. It is literally people's movement. So we had 40 signatures for every one of theirs. So therefore the debate was over. And therefore the media also stopped because they figured that they are fueling this response, this angry response. That's how this book came out. So it's the fact that we won this battle for Sanskrit by having this book out is actually a victory for social media.
Understand one thing. Democracy is a system of competitive lobbies. The lobby for Sanskrit is dying. We are not talking, we are not speaking, and we are taxpayers. Government spends our money. Siddaramaiah may not like Sanskrit. The JDU may not like Sanskrit for political reasons, ideological reasons. But we the people have to come together, petition him and tell him we better do it. We are the voters. We would ask him to spend our money wisely, and we must write a petition, change all this, go to court and change all this, become more activists. The only way we have to come together is, like, I'll tell you, why are our temples under the control of the government?
Very
it's
good.
Illegal. All over the country. And the law is, freedom of religion says subject to public order. And public order also in the court decision says you can take control for public order for a limited time. But government had made it permanent time. And let me give you some data, which is shameful. Tirupati has 7,000 crore bank deposits. 7,000 crores. Why are they keeping the money? They must send it by culture, for Sanskrit, for schools, for colleges. And in the footage of Tirupati, evangelicals are converting people, coming to Tirupati and doing it. And they've got 7,000 crores in the bank. What are the value of 7,000 crores? Why are we keeping quiet? Why are people keeping quiet? Because you have lost control. You're not writing, you're not lobbying. Let's get a lobby. You must get a lobby, write petitions, make it public, fight, march on the street, go to the media, automatically things will change. That is the power of democracy.
Very good.
My question is to Rajiv sir. You have often said that the sages and Swamiji's here are dismissive of your work, saying it doesn't matter, they are doing their own sadhana and stuff. How do you plan to engage them? Because I think it's very important because they have huge following in millions, and most of them are not on social media, and it's important that we
I never said that all of them are like that. In fact, some of my best supporters are Swamis, and in Bombay we are doing an event at Chinmay Mission. Chinmay Mission in Washington has invited me many times, Canada has invited me many times. On the 24th, Shri Shri Ravi Shankar is launching this book in his headquarters, this same book. I have several, Swami Dayanand Saraswati was a great friend and mentor and helping me all the time and having me come and teach his sadhus. In fact, classes when they were becoming sadhus, I would be invited to give workshops there. So I could go on. ISKCON, a lot of friends in ISKCON were inviting me. So I don't think it's a universal statement. It used to be the case, I would say, when I started this, that the spiritual people didn't want to get involved in controversy. They want to take a safe way. And they were more into the otherworldly realm and kind of withdrawn, introverted, and did not want to take action. I think what changed is I was brought into those movements as a speaker by the constant lobbying of the consumers. So Baba Ramdev, when he called me, he says, so many people have been saying, unko bulao, unko bulao. Now I'm so happy you are here. So he didn't know of me, but his followers would constantly say that you got to bring this guy. Same thing happened with Art of Living. Same thing happened with Chinmay Mission. Chinmay Mission, I have so many friends and supporters who are part of my group from Chinmay Mission that they keep telling their swamis that you have to come. You have to bring this guy. So I think the things are changing. I now intend to approach Jaggi Vasudev, because so many of his followers have been writing to me, and they're part of my discussion group, and one day we will also have a meeting there. I'm going tomorrow to Amrita University, Mata Amritanand's University, and I've been there 5 or 6 times. So I don't think, and Ramakrishna Mission in Chennai is hosting me. I've been to there. So I think it's not universally true. Now, I have a lot of experience in dealing with these groups, so I can tell you who's what. So a group like Ramakrishna Mission is not a universal, uniform policy. In one center, one matha, they may really want me, like Swami Harshananji in the center here. He's 86. Brilliant man. He endorses every one of my books. He's going to inaugurate the workshop I'm doing on the 19th. He's going to sit there. He's totally on my wavelength, always encouraging me. Yet, when you go to some other Ramakrishna Mission areas, they don't want to touch controversy. They don't want to get involved in these things. They think it's not their business. So even within the same Ramakrishna Mission, you'll see different people taking different views. Similarly, in Chinmay Mission, different people taking different views. So I think we are entering these spaces. We are entering them and making an impact. Especially young people can go and continue the lobbying with their swamis. And Swami listens to their own followers. So swamis are changing because their followers are coming. See, I won't mention this name because I don't want to spoil my relationship with a particular group. But a very, very major group in the US used to invite me for their annual fundraiser as the speaker. And they would raise a lot of money. And I would be happy just to make sure that, you know, they're getting some thing. And when I started my books, first book they invited me, it was a huge success. And then after a while, because of all kind of controversies in the press, the Swamiji said that, no, we can't call him this time, you know, because, you know, it's not, they were more concerned about their own PR. So the teachers of their Bal Vihars and these, the various classes they hold, these teachers got together, lobbied the Swami that you have to bring him. So they then wrote a list of questions that their children have, which the Swamiji and his curriculum do not talk about. And they said, our curriculum is limited to certain kind of spiritual discourse, but these are problems and issues about Hinduism that we need. And this guy is talking about it. Our people are not talking about it. So if you don't want him, then you have to teach all this. So they won the debate. So I was invited by the Swamiji because the people wanted it. So we are changing things now. We're changing quite rapidly.
My question is, start with a small Hindi kahavat. Hame to apno ne hi luta, gairo mein kaha dam tha, jahan hamari kishti dubi, wahan pani hi dam tha.
Good.
Hence, this is a very, very bitter kind of reality, that in the Hinduism itself, we don't have a common unity with which we can go with a common interest. This is what I think sometimes that actually prevails us. Once, if we get the unity, if we get interest in our cultures, if we are able to know that, I think we can make a long impact, sir, because what I feel, let's see, even in a small village, I can find a Christian missionary school. But I don't find much Vedic schools that are teaching so much things with the science and things. And second is that most of our controls are under the Western media, Western channels. They decide what news to publish. So how can we control ourselves, our own country, Please give me the answer.
Arey bhaiya, you have to understand what a civilization is. Our civilization is a polytheistic, heterogeneous civilization where there are multiple views. There cannot be one single view, one Ramayana. Not acceptable. Because one Ramayana will lead to dictatorship of the mind. Will lead to monotheism. You could have control. You could have a central organization. You could do many things. But you lose the soul of human existence, the freedom of thought. There will be dogma. So our civilization is multiple views, freedom of expression to the ultimate nth degree. So we must cherish this. So we must join on large issues, on interpretations we don't have, we can disagree, but we must join on civilizational issues as Indians.
Yeah, that's what.
But you've got to be careful when you pose the question. We cannot have one single monotheistic organization which is going to tell us what has to be done. In fact, in North India, they want to say only the Valmiki Ramayana, the Ramayana some people are promoting is not acceptable. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Please cherish this. This is the most important thing, why we have lasted as a civilization 5,000 years. Everybody has died. We have lasted and we will last. Because ultimate proof is open system. We're open system. Closed propriety system, die. Open system karo. Cherish it, please.
See, I'll tell you, let me tell you. My view is that since I go and talk to all kind of sampradayas and paramparas of Hinduism, I never interfere with their spiritual interpretation, their ritual, who is their guru, what is the symbols, kya kapdai dalte hain, kya karte hain. I want to respect all of them. Whoever I go to, I bow before them, I go to their mandir, I comply with whatever their protocol is, I respect every one of them. The way I want to, what I want to unify them is external affairs, not home affairs. What they're doing internally, they should keep doing. But how do we tackle the rest of the world? We can have a united front. That is where we need the unity. Right.
Second thing, like our education system to what the media, everything is in the control of this Western kind of people. So Aray. How can we make control on us?
Arey bhaiya, abhi free hai, aap hi likho, aap hi baat karo, sab aa jayega, organize karo, that's all. Please karo. Aapne kitna baar likha hai? How many articles have written about your views? How many Twitter things have you done? How many blogs have you written? Write more. Collect group of people, 10 people, 20 people, 30 people, put some money, do something, organize. They're organized, you're not organized, organize. See, the idea should win. There cannot be dogma, the best idea should win. And that is what we are. In our civilization, the best idea wins. Shankara came and then Mangala Mitra, right?
Yeah.
Mandala Mitra, different and debate. That's the power of the idea. And that we should cherish. So we may look at different times of being conquered by others because we don't have organization. But at the end of the day, the power of the idea ultimately wins. But like he says, external affairs. In America, they say, don't interfere the bedroom and the boardroom for politicians. Do anything else, you do what you want.
How to uncover it? See, this is Roddam Narasimha's long discussion debate with me on this very issue. Yeah, so this is already happening. People are like IIT Bombay is teaching this course. There's a Rama Subramaniam, a professor there, and then there is a Ganesh Ramakrishnan and various other people. They've actually some years ago I gave some talks there. And one of the action items was that they'll go to the faculty and they'll create a center for studies of our civilization. They actually, rather than complaining, they said, let's do it. And so now they it's official, formal, part of the university curriculum, they are studying this. IIT Bombay, very prestigious place. So in pockets, this is beginning to happen. BHU has some of these things happening. Deccan College, the Vasant Shinde is the vice chancellor. He wrote one of the 10 volumes of our, which we produced in our foundation. He wrote one of those. He's an archaeologist. So he is very much into these things. So pockets of people here and there are doing it. And in their own particular institutes, started teaching classes. But it has not been something, I went to many people, when Murli Manohar Joshi was the HRD, he came to New York, and the Consul General invited me to have a private dinner with him because he had heard of my work. And I told him I'm doing this history of science and technology. He was very appreciative, thought this is great. But then there was no follow-up by their side. Nobody did anything. And then when Kapil Sibal was the Minister of Science for a while, Ram Jethmalani and his family, they introduced me to him because they knew him. And we took volumes, we had 4 or 5 volumes at the time, and he was very, very appreciative and said, we will get back to you, but nothing happened. Nothing happened. So I don't know about how the government, how to convince them, but I'm seeing traction in particular universities happening right now.
Sir, are you doing means, is there any linkage happening between all these pockets?
Yes. We used to have funding. Every year, my foundation used to hold an annual conference on history of Indian science and technology. We had them in 5 or 6 different places, kept repeating, including one in Deccan College, including in Delhi, and in 5 or 6 places we've had this. Jaipur, we had one. So we just stopped doing it because we just didn't have the funding to continue. But we were bringing more and more people who are on this wavelength together every year, and then they would learn from each other, and then they would go back to the university and start teaching it. Now, Indus University in Ahmedabad has signed a collaboration with our foundation. They want to revive this. So they want to revive. Last year we had, after a gap of many years, we had a conference on science and history of Indian science and technology to bring all the to network these people together.
Thank you so much.
We should have in Bangalore, Rajiv.
I would love to.
One minute. Rajiv, I think we should have in Bangalore. We'll arrange the funding for you.
If you arrange the funding.
Annually, a history of science and technology.
Do it.
In the ISE. If ISE agrees, we'll have it here.
You do it. If you get the funding, we will do it. We have the talent. We have people who've done this work. We have about 200 Indian scholars. I'll tell you 2 things we have created. I can say that. First was a field called Indian psychology. We've created.
Is there Indian psychology also? I thought only Freud wrote psychology.
No, the psychology, Indian mind. The Indian theories of mind.
Like Indian mind also.
Indian mind also. India mein mind bhi hai, but theory of mind bhi hai. What happened is, IIT Kharagpur, when they were celebrating their 50th anniversary, they applied for a grant to sponsor one of the many conferences they wanted. And the one which attracted my interest was mind sciences. They had a conference called mind sciences. So I said, I'm interested in this, send me details. But the details they sent me, all Western theories of mind. Freud and Jung and this one and that one, those kind of things. So I wrote back that I will sponsor the conference if at least one panel is on Indian theories of mind. I got a very nasty letter saying we are not Saffron, we are scientists, as this kind of thing. I still keep it. And the lady who sent it now turned around to our side, and she's championing the kind of work that we do. And every time I meet her, I kind of remind her of this. So how I turned it around. I knew they have inferiority complex, and if I get white people, they will accept it. So I went to one fellow who is a Sri Aurobindo follower in the United States to write a proposal on Sri Aurobindo's theory of mind, one Buddhist guy, Westerner, one Patanjali Yoga Sutra, one Kundalini. I got 4 or 5 Westerners from various places to write an abstract and proposal. I told them, this is your payback time to the mother civilization from which you've learned. And now you should pay back by going there. I'll fund you. But you go there and talk and tell them who was your guru. Don't try to do mumbo jumbo that this is Western thought. Don't appropriate it. Tell them the Indian source, who taught you, how you are practicing it, how you're teaching it to Westerners, and it is benefiting them. So this panel was instantly accepted because it's white guys. And then Kharagpur mein, jab this conference happened, they all got standing ovations. And so then suddenly people from the audience started inviting them to Kerala, to inviting them to Pondicherry, the Indian psychology departments.
Oh, Indian psychology.
Because now it was legitimate to talk about it because the Westerners were saying things. So it must be good because Westerners are saying it can't be Saffron. So Westerners helped me convince the Indians to allow these things. So we did series for 7-8 years. We did one conference after another. We created that in that context. I met several people from Bangalore also. Sangeeta Menon was a PhD student, and we funded her many, many times to go and give these classes and built her up as a person. Like that, we built up several people in India to become experts in Indian theories of mind. And after about 8 or 9 years of doing that, now there is a group who meet once a year, And they consider themselves to be the academic scholars on Indian theories of mind. So a whole discipline has been created by doing this. And the second one is history of Indian science and technology, where we are playing a role. These two areas, we can say we've done some pioneering work with some effect. In dialogue with who? In dialogue with who? You have to request your leaders, like in the spiritual organizations. I was brought in because so many people in various spiritual organizations continued lobbying to their leader, and the Swamiji said, okay, let's bring this guy, and then I was in. So in your organization, it is you have to do that, because people at the very high level tend to be surrounded by insiders and do not have an outside perspective. I found this in the corporate world. As a management consultant, the top guys would bring a person like me from the outside because they were too insulated and they were getting the same views. And so they needed an outside perspective. So any big old organization becomes stodgy unless you bring outsiders. And I don't want to name organizations, but I think certain organizations in India have become inbred, stodgy, built on obedience, not on challenging, not on provocative ideas. And they should all get somebody equivalent to a McKinsey to do a SWOT analysis: strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, threats, shake things up. And they need to bring outside executives into their positions. I used to do turnaround management as a consultant for big companies who had these kind of problems, the AT&Ts and these kind of, very successfully. And one of the standard things to do is to bring outside management. Not all the management, but certain amount of outside blood you need to bring in. So you have to tackle internal to your organization why it is that they have conclave but don't invite me. They invite, half the people they invite are actually reading my stuff and repackaging it. They even tell me that. But why they don't invite, because I don't know. You have to discuss and try to convince them.
Yeah, do you see a panoramic view of the opposition to Sanskrit, or it's only the Charvakas or the atheism?
No, the politicization, as he says, the politicization is because of a lot of lobby groups. And the lobby groups each have to find a cause and to differentiate themselves from others and create victimhood, that mereko usko unhone victim kar diya, unki galti hai. So this victimization is a powerful weapon. Of course, it's divisive, but this is what fuels the politician's agenda. Now, countering this is Sanskrit Bharati. I was in the morning with Sanskrit Bharati, very impressed. We had 400 people there, standing room. And I said, how many such groups do you have in India? They said 500. 500 groups in India. So if you look at the number of people they're teaching, how rapidly they're growing, grassroots, poor people, it's very amazing. And they told me that some of the biggest successes of Sanskrit Bharati is in the slum areas. It's in the Dalit communities. It's in the very poor people. They want to learn Sanskrit. So this business of Sanskrit being elitist is being challenged.
Sir, no.
Thank you.